NASA's Orion spacecraft, which is part of the Artemis program, is now back on Earth. It splashed down off the coast of Mexico after almost 4 weeks in space. During its flight, Orion traveled to a point more than 268,000 miles from Earth. That is further than any other spacecraft designed to carry humans. The Orion crew capsule, where astronauts will sit during future flights, it re-entered the Earth's atmosphere at just over 24,000 miles per hour. Now, the mission, which had no astronauts on board, it was designed to show that the capsule's heat shield could withstand temperatures of up to 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit. That's hot. One of NASA's next projects is the SWOT mission. Now, SWOT is an abbreviation for Surface, Water, and Ocean Topography. Okay, we love a good acronym. And it is also the name of the satellite, which will be launched aboard a SpaceX rocket from the Vandenberg Space Force Base in California this month. SWOT will survey nearly all of the water on Earth's surface for the first time ever. Now, one goal of the mission is to examine the impact our warmer climate is having on the world's water supply. So joining us now to discuss it all is Dr. Thomas Zurbuchen. He is an associate administrator for NASA's Science Mission Directorate and lead science for the SWOT mission. He is also an astrophysicist, y'all. Okay, so Dr. Z knows a little something about all of it. I am so glad you are here today. We talked about the impact of climate change a little bit, and I'm just wondering if you can just tell folks how historic this mission is and why it matters for the future of really our world.
I'm really glad to be here and talking to you. It's really clear how much you're excited you are about this. But so what we're doing with SWOT is really a first ever in humanity's history here. And that is that we're mapping all lakes and rivers from the sky. You say, why would we be interested in that? Well, look, water is a really important contributor to life and to communities worldwide. And frankly, we're running out of water in some areas. We have too much water in other areas, and we really want to map them every week to make sure that we can, you know, distribute the water the right way and manage it.
So what are the, you know, I used to work for the vice president, and she used to always say, future wars will be fought over water. And I think we are seeing the ramifications of the climate crisis in every space and place in our everyday lives. And NASA is an important part of combating the climate crisis. So what are some of these data points that the satellite will be able to emit down to NASA? What are you guys looking for?
So look at the Western United States, for example, right, where we have had drought conditions in many of the areas, fires in so many of the other areas. And what we need, of course, is to combat these fires is water. And what we need to feed these communities, and many of them, frankly, tribal communities downriver, right, and is information about water. So what we're going to do the moment the spacecraft is up and checked out is really provide that information with unprecedented accuracy to the managers there, but see, not only in the United States, but also in Africa, in South America, and so many of these areas. And so for us, it really, just like you said, it's going to be all about water. Mm-hmm. And we're measuring it for the first time with this international mission, really coming together and providing true value from space.
Dr. Zurbuchen, how quickly, I mean, I have this idea of the satellite going up, it gets set up, and then the stuff is getting zapped down, and there's somebody at a computer, and they can see all the data in real time. Is that how it works?
Well, we launch it. This satellite needs to be deployed, so it has antennas that go out like 30 feet on the side just to make sure that we can actually focus on these rivers and lakes. That will take a few weeks, right, to set everything up and make sure that actually the spacecraft works exactly like we hope. And then once it's operating, yes, it takes the data, it sends the data back over the network globally, and within hours or days, you know, the data are made available. And hopefully, what we're really trying hard to do is not only the data, but also the interpretation of the data, the science, make those available to communities worldwide. That's why all of these data will be openly available and accessible from anywhere.
This is absolutely amazing. Okay, well, I can't wait to hear about all the things, and I could imagine that this data could lead to some potential changes in our daily lives, depending on what we find out and what we get.
Without a doubt. What we are doing from space, looking at our home planet, is changing our lives. It protects lives in many areas, whether it's storms that we're also helping to detect together with our cross-agency partners, or whether we can show kind of slower things that really come from climate change to basically say, hey, look, we have a problem here. We need to start investing in infrastructure to protect those communities.
Absolutely amazing. Folks at home might not know Dr. Zurbuchen, but you are actually NASA's longest serving associate administrator for science. But come New Year's Eve, you are wrapping it up and retiring from this long career. You have helmed over 100, almost 100 missions, everything from the most powerful telescope in the world to ever launch to this groundbreaking SWAT mission. As you reflect on your career, what have you learned? What's different from NASA now than when you started?
So first and foremost, what I'm really proud of is if you look at our team, we opened many doors. Our teams are a lot more exciting than we used to be. We have people from different backgrounds, different communities, from inner cities, from rural communities, some immigrants like I am and others coming together and building the best teams. What's also exciting as we look forward is, you know, it's cheaper to get to space than it used to be. And because of the fact that there are companies out there that help us get there. So what we can do is really serve this terrestrial community from space better. And we can do that in partnerships with companies, international partnerships with more and more countries investing in space. So I think for us, as we serve this community here, our future is bright.
You're going to miss NASA?
Oh, I will always miss NASA. And I've been so honored to serve in this role, and I will never forget it. But I will also be a cheerleader for NASA and all its partners.
That's right. Let me just, speaking from experience, on the outside, it's not too bad out here outside the federal government, let me just say. Dr. Thomas Zurbuchen, thank you so much for being here and just for your service. We appreciate you.
Really appreciate it. Thank you so much, and thanks for yours.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.